Hi, everyone. My name is Gregory Creswell, a Libertarian and a candidate for governor. Michigan clearly needs a new direction, and believe me, please, it will never come from the two major parties. For a new direction, we must elect Libertarians to public office throughout this state. This, we believe, is easy to do if you are tired of the myth that Michigan is a two-party state. Please allow me to give you five good reasons to vote Libertarian. Number one, we strongly support the idea that everything you own belongs to you and no one else. Number two, that everyone is equal under the law. Number three, we will defend individual rights, private property rights, and privacy rights. Number four, that politicians have far too much power and control over our lives. And number five, we support a free market economy where politicians do not have the power to force a business to pay a fee, buy a permit, or purchase a license, and surely not to tax our property. We Libertarians would cut the pay, perks, benefits, and staff size if we win. And we would also provide huge tax cuts for everyone because the money you earn belongs to you and no one else. But if you believe that politicians should have your money, we would open up a Tax Me More fund for anyone to donate to. As I finish up, let me fill you in on some code words that politicians use. Like, for instance, invest in our citizens. That means they want to raise our taxes, spend our money, and worse yet, waste it. Also, do it for the children. It means to use the children so that politicians can benefit from it to gain more power and control. And lastly, tax base. That means politicians see us as a money machine, someone to tax. Now, before I forget, please go to our website, www.gregcreswell.org, or email me at gcreswell@yahoo.com. To finish up, we are asking that you vote Libertarian, that you vote yes on Proposal 2 and Proposal 4, and no on Proposal 5. Thanks for giving me a chance to express myself. God bless you, your family, the troops, and the United States. I am Greg Creswell, candidate for governor, Libertarian Party here in Michigan.
If the American Civil Rights Institute has its way, every state constitution would include an anti-preference amendment. This would not allow state-run universities or government entities from selecting students, employees, or vendors based on race, gender, or ethnicity. Its goal is to end affirmative action as we know it today. Currently, a petition drive is underway in Michigan to put an anti-preference proposal on the Michigan election ballot. What does this mean to us here in Michigan? We will explore this issue on Politics Aside. This is not your grandmother's civil rights movement. On a national level, the American Civil Rights Institute has convinced Californians to adopt Proposition 209, which prohibits the state of California from discriminating or giving preferential treatment based on race, gender, ethnicity, national origin, or color. Washington State has followed suit, and Michigan is in the midst of a similar challenge. We talked to Professor Robert Sedler at Wayne State University's Law School to get a deeper understanding of affirmative action, its intent, and who is affected by it.
Affirmative action refers to using race in a positive way to accomplish an important objective, such as achieving racial diversity in the classroom, overcoming the consequences of identified past discrimination for which the government is responsible, such as the City of Detroit's affirmative action program for the police and fire department to overcome past discrimination against African Americans and women in the hiring of police officers and firefighters, and in a broader sense, to overcome the present consequences of a long and tragic history of racial discrimination in this country, which has left African Americans and some other racial minorities, such as Hispanic and Native Americans, underrepresented in the important areas of societal power. And the reason that I use the term government is that whenever the government uses race, there is always a potential constitutional challenge. But there is affirmative action by employers, which is subject to civil rights laws, but private entities are not subject to the requirements of the Constitution. The Constitution only runs against the government. That's often not understood. Well, I myself go back to the post-Civil War period, where Congress set up the Freedmen's Bureau and other programs to benefit the newly freed African-American slaves. And then the affirmative action kind of came to an end with the end of Reconstruction. I saw it surfacing again in the 1960s, in the wake of the Brown decision, civil rights laws such as the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and those of us who had been involved in the civil rights struggle, many of us, realized that anti-discrimination laws alone, while they would prevent things from getting worse, would not overcome the present consequences of the past governmental and societal discrimination. And so that is when the concept of affirmative action developed, to use race in a positive way to achieve objectives such as diversity, such as overcoming the government's own past discrimination and overcoming the consequences of a long and tragic history of societal discrimination.
Politics aside, we'll continue in a moment. But first, we'll hear how Metro Detroiters responded to the question, do you believe your race or gender has ever stopped you from achieving your goals?
Not really.
I don't believe so.
Not once.
Most definitely.
Not exactly.
Yeah, there have been times when that's happened.
Hello. Yes, can I ask a few questions about the apartment on Park Street?
What was your name?
My name is Juan Hernandez.
It's been rented.
Oh, it's gone.
Hello, my name is Sanjay Kumar. I am calling about the apartment on Park Street.
It's not available.
Not available?
Hello, my name is Tyrone Washington. I'm calling about the apartment on Park Street.
Just been rented.
Hello, I am Chen Ling.
My name is Khalid Bin Ali.
I'm Tuan Vo.
Hello, my name is Moshe Goldberg. I use a wheelchair.
It's gone.
Not available.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, hello, my name is Graham Wellington. I'm calling about the apartment for rent on Park Street. Is that still available?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Really?
Housing discrimination is illegal. If you think you've been a victim because of your race, color, national origin, sex, religion, disability, or family status, call us. Fair housing. It's not an option. It's the law.
Save a place for me. Save a space for me. In your heart. In your heart.
Every year, the United Negro College Fund helps thousands of students go to college. But for everyone we help, there's one we can't. Please support the United Negro College Fund. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
Channel 10, can you dig it?
Ward Connerly is the founder of the American Civil Rights Institute. He has gained national attention for his effort to end racial preferences. His opponents describe his actions as anti-affirmative action. Some even question his motives for ending a practice that has provided so many business, academic, and career opportunities for people of color. Mr. Connerly is based in California, and we spoke to him by phone. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Connerly. Is your proposal aimed at colleges specifically, or is it aimed at preferences that exist in the corporate arena? And I'm speaking to the diversity trends that we see happening across America.
Well, first of all, the proposal has nothing to do with the private sector. It only relates to government. It says the state, small s, shall not discriminate against or grant preferential treatment in the arenas of public education, public contracting, and public employment. So it has nothing to do with the corporate world. That needs to be very, very clear. But it does affect every government agency in the state of Michigan or California or Washington, because all of us are citizens of whatever venue we are, that we reside in, and we're all presumed to have equal treatment under the law. I mean, you know, this really isn't rocket science. If you look at the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and you look at the whole civil rights movement, the concept that everybody is going to be treated equally is not, you know, this is not new. I'm not foisting some new novel concept on people here. I mean, I just don't understand why we have gotten, or how we've gotten to the point that we can rationalize treating people differently on the basis of skin color, and then putting me in the position where I'm having to defend the principle of equal treatment under the law. I mean, it's insane.
What do you hope will ultimately happen as a result of this work that you're doing?
I hope the country will realize that we do no one any advantage by treating them differently because of their skin color or their gender or where their ancestors came from. With respect to black people who have been marginalized all of our, throughout their history, the idea that you're going to give them a different standard to live by or give them some perceived preference only marginalizes them further and only prolongs the day when black people need to be seated at the table as an equal and not judged differently. Let's face it, people who give preferences, they really don't believe that black people are going to be able to compete without them. They really don't subscribe to the notion of tough love and you set a standard and you hold everybody accountable for it. I found that throughout my life. If you set the bar at this level, black people can rise to it just like everybody else. And when you start saying, we really need affirmative action, give them affirmative action, and I emphasize give them affirmative action. People aren't doing that because they think that black people are equal. They're doing it because they believe either that there is rampant racial discrimination, which makes no sense because in the college venue, every college in the country is bending over backwards to get black people and Latinos in because they want this diversity. So there's no discrimination there. To the contrary. And so when people have these policies that treat people differently, they really are following their own belief that black people and Latinos really aren't going to measure up in the absence of these preferences.
The name of your organization is the American Civil Rights Institute. There are some who say that the fact that you use the word civil rights in the name of your organization is misleading. How do you respond to that?
Civil rights are for everybody, not just for black people. And so by saying we're the American Civil Rights Institute, American Civil Rights Coalition, and we're subscribing to the view that everybody is entitled to equal treatment under the law, that is the essence of civil rights. That is what civil rights are supposed to be. So we don't despoil that term. They do. When you say that somebody should be treated differently from somebody else because of their skin color, you can hide behind the noble-sounding terms of affirmative action or diversity. The reality is you're saying people should be treated differently, and that's not what civil rights are. Civil rights are equal treatment for everybody. The fact of the matter is that they believe that when the term civil rights is used, it is supposed to be used exclusively for the benefit of black people. They're saying the civil rights movement was a movement to right the wrongs that had been perpetrated against black people. I believe that the civil rights movement was a movement in which our country came to terms with the concept of treating people differently, regardless of what their background is.
Do you believe that black people as a whole are looking for special privileges just because they're black?
Well, not as a whole, but I think that there are some who are in fact wanting that, who believe that it's time to get even and this is something that we deserve, and they still are looking in the past, believing that racism is rampant and that that's an excuse to have different standards applied. Yeah, I think that there are some. I don't think as a whole that's the case. But that's the only rationale you can find for what is called affirmative action, that it's time to compensate, time to make up. It's all part of the reparations argument, essentially, that this is something that is owed to us. And I don't subscribe to that at all.
Thank you, Mr. Connerly. Politics aside, we'll continue in a moment.
Imagine what America would be like today if Martin Luther King never had a dream. Help keep the dream alive. To find out more about the Martin Luther King Memorial in Washington, D.C., call or log on now.
AIDS has killed more children worldwide than there are in all the grade schools in New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Washington, Atlanta, and Miami combined. The time to do something is now. The place is apathyislethal.org.
Let's play a game. Let's pretend you own an apartment building and I want to rent from you. I make a good salary, have a good credit history. Would you rent your place to me? How about now? Do you still like me? What if I have an accent or a disability? What if I'm a single parent? Would you steer me away? Would you close the door? Would you?
The Fair Housing Act protects your right to live where you want. If you think you've been discriminated against, call us.
People all over the world have fought for the right to vote.
For years, I paid poll tax for me and my wife because I was hoping sooner or later that it would be a time that we could vote.
Free to make choices and free to choose direction in their lives. If that were all taken away, where would we be? Take the time to register and vote. Your right to choose is at stake.
Feel Detroit. Feel the city. On Channel 10.
The Michigan Civil Rights Initiative is a local organization supported by Ward Connerly out of California. Its goals are to place the so-called anti-affirmative action proposal on the Michigan ballot in November. We spoke to local spokesperson Greg Creswell, who hopes that Michigan will follow the same path as California and Washington State. We started our conversation with Greg by asking him what were the goals of his organization.
We are a group of citizens in Michigan trying to put on the ballot this issue of affirmative action, where the government would not decide based on color, race, sex, et cetera, who will be enrolled into the state universities, U of M, Michigan State, Eastern Michigan, et cetera.
Why did you take up this cause?
I believe that this is the right cause for myself as an individual to help cease politicians from using color as a basis as to who will be enrolled into the state universities, U of M, Wayne State, et cetera.
Why is that important to you?
As a citizen and as an individual, I resent politicians separating us by color. They did that back down south using Jim Crow laws. Of course, they used that for slavery, too. And I think it's equally offensive and immoral for them to use a racial preference, which is what I call racial preferences, to enroll students into state universities throughout this state.
You mentioned that your issue is largely with politicians who make the separation. Let's just talk about history for a moment.
Sure.
You know about the civil rights movement.
Sure,
you know
I sure
about
do.
Jim Crow laws, because you mentioned that yourself.
Yes.
Why do you think it's politicians versus the public, the society as a whole?
Well, politicians are the ones that pass the laws. I also blame the citizens for voting for the politicians that pass these laws. Also, there are in some cases where citizens can do a petition drive, pass certain laws that separate us as opposed to seeing us as an individual. Citizens, through politicians, use all types of oppressive and suppressive laws to curtail our rights. Jim Crow was an evil law that was passed down south, throughout the South. And equally, I think affirmative action and racial preferences are just as immoral and offensive, in my opinion.
You go back to saying that people should be judged based on their own merit.
Yes.
But how do you believe that changing the direction of affirmative action is really going to help in practical purpose?
I believe through tradition, through belief that a person just cannot play basketball just because he's black, or he can run fast just because he's black, or he can swim because he's white or she's white, or he's good in math and science because he's Asian. I think when you take away affirmative action and racial preference, then there'll be the mindset will say, well, that person can do it if the person can pass this test. For years, when I would watch TV, for instance, ESPN sports station, the athletes back in the 60s and early 70s talked and spoke in a clear diction where you could understand them. And as a person who stutters, I can pick it up real good of a person who can speak real nice. But today, the athletes, a lot of them are black, speak in a fashion that I cringe and know that, and I think to myself, wow, this person went to college and they haven't gotten any better in the words they pronounce. I guess because I pick it up as a person who stutters, when a person could say, when a person uses the word you know, or a lot, I pick it up a lot. So I think the sinfulness of low expectation is behind this affirmative action thing, where whites, liberal whites, pity blacks, and so they say, in my opinion, that since they can't do it without my help, I'm gonna put my arms around them and help them along, as opposed to, you do it, we know we held you back with slavery and Jim Crow laws, so We're going to help get rid of all these oppressive laws that we have, and then you can compete. We can be champions in science and math, because a lot of black inventors were inventing things even when racism was raw and in your face daily in the 20th and 19th century.
You mentioned tradition, and you equated that with stereotypes, how people equate African Americans with athletics and so on.
Yes.
What about the tradition on the flip side of that, where people of European descent have practiced oppression with people of color?
Yes, oh yes, they have.
So how does this help?
What we do is destroy the laws that they have created, and then support the right of the individual to succeed. And I believe this country will be much better. There are many laws today that are still on the books in Detroit that were created by white folks that stifle even black citizens' individual rights and freedom to succeed and excel throughout the city. So what I determined to be something very obvious is that it wasn't the color of the skin that was my oppressor, it was the mindset of that person who has been oppressing me and other citizens throughout this country.
Has there ever been a time in your life where you believe that affirmative action has worked in your favor?
No, never for me or against me. What I'm, I have no evidence either way. What I'm trying to advocate, though, is that I got to where I am as an individual based on my merit. I have been at companies or jobs where I felt that I was not treated in a proper manner, so I left because that's the mindset that I have. It's their company. It's not my job. It's not my business. So if they weren't doing the things that I felt that they should, I just left and was someplace else.
Did you ever feel that at any time the mistreatment that you felt was because of your race?
No. I just think that it was just because the person, in my opinion, and I just didn't click. And it could, and it's the same as dating. The lady may have a preference when it comes to dating, and so I didn't fit that standard. So I was let go, so to speak, and I moved on. And there were some persons who I wouldn't hire to come into my place of my home as a plumber or electrician because of the standards that I have, and so they weren't hired. And I've hired Hispanic plumbers, electrician, black Hispanic, white, white plumbers, or black plumbers, or mechanics to work on my family car. So it's based on my preference, which is a standard, which is a merit.
As an African-American male, have you ever faced discrimination or racism in your life?
Sure, as of right now, as a person who stutters, I know that stutterers aren't going to be allowed to have talk shows, anchor TV shows, do reporting. I, as a Libertarian member, am not asked or have a chance to work for a person who is a non-Libertarian in a law offices or the clerk office or work for a judge. So I see it every day, but I'm not out there trying to use the courts, a judge, or pass a law to further my cause. What I want to do is force the politicians, force the citizens to see me as an individual and use my merit as a goal.
Thank you, Greg, for coming.
I was flattered. Thank you very much for having me here. I appreciate it.
Petitions for the anti-preference proposal have been circulating in Michigan for some time now. If members of the Michigan Civil Rights Initiative are successful, you will see this proposal on the Michigan ballot in November. We asked Ward Connerly to give us a progress report with respect to this petition drive. He said the information was not available. On the next episode of Politics Aside, you will hear from Detroit area organizations who disagree with the assertions made by Ward Connerly and Greg Creswell. Before we leave you, more comments from Metro Detroiters.
Do you believe at any time that your race or gender has prohibited you from achieving your goals? Not once. It's all about confidence and the way you feel as a person and the way you carry yourself. And I haven't experienced that, no.
No, I don't believe at all that my race has prohibited me in any ways.
What about gender?
Not my gender either.
I don't think it's really stopped me. I think that all my goals have been achieved through my own merits, and I hope that everyone achieves their own goals through their merits and not based on what their race is or what their gender is.
Being a white woman